I have to say that I really do enjoy playing my Nintendo Switch. That is why one day I thought to myself, how awesome would it be to have a device with a similar form factor that can not only play retro games, but can also be used as a Windows 10 tablet. Sadly though, such a device does not exist, so I had no other choice than to build one by myself. It can be powered by a USB Type-C PD power source like a power bank, comes with a touchscreen to easily control the Windows 10 operating system, and also features all important gamepad buttons, which are mandatory for some retro gaming. So sit back and enjoy the journey of me creating this device, so that you can easily rebuild it at home. Let's get started! This video is sponsored by JLC PCB, which offers cheap but still high quality PCBs, stencils and SMT assembly for your projects. They currently offer $7 coupons for SMT assembly, and PCB prices do as always start at $2. So upload your Gerber files today and try out their service. Let's start off with the heart of the system, which is this LattePanda single board computer. Now, it might not be the cheapest SBC on the market, but it certainly comes with rather powerful specifications for its size. Has Windows 10 installed, features lots of ports just like a proper computer, and even has a built-in Arduino, which we will later use for the gamepads. To test it, all I had to do was to connect a 5-volt power source, wait for the red LED to turn off, and then hold the power button until the red LED starts glowing again. But obviously, I forgot all about a display for this mini computer. For that, I got myself this Waveshare 7-inch HDMI LCD with integrated capacitive touchscreen. Its price was once again not that low, but I have to say that its picture quality is pretty good, the touchscreen works perfectly, and it even comes with an audio power amplifier, which we will later use to add a small speaker to the gaming system. So next, I used this small and flat HDMI cable to connect the display to the LattePanda, used a micro USB cable to connect the touch port of the display to a USB port of the LattePanda, and finally used another micro USB cable hooked up to the power only port, which I connected to a separate 5-volt power source. But since I later only want to use one 5-volt power source for the gaming system, which powers both the LattePanda and the screen, I cut up both power wires, removed the insulation of the red 5-volt and black ground wire, grabbed myself a micro USB breakout board and soldered all four wires to the corresponding 5-volt or ground pads. After then plugging this micro USB breakout in only one power source, we can see that the system does work just fine, at least until a certain point, since the combined current draw of both devices exceed the current capabilities of our power source. And since I later want to power the system with a power bank, which comes with the same current limit of 2 amps, we might have a serious problem here. Thankfully though, I got one of those USB Type-C PD PCBs laying around, which I presented you in one of my previous videos about USB Type-C. Simply put, by using a USB Type-C cable and a compatible USB Type-C PD power bank, we can get 3 amps of current instead of just 2. So I soldered all wires of the system to the circuits, powered it up, and as you can see, this time everything works without any problems. And after confirming that all functions of Windows 10 work flawlessly, by also watching some of my own videos, I went over to the RetroArch website, which is the software that I will be using for the retro gaming aspects. Now, I will not go into detail here on how to set up this software, because honestly speaking, there are already enough videos about that topic. But as soon as you're basically done with setting the software up, you can use a keyboard to play some retro games, like for example Golden Axe right here. Needless to say though, we cannot fit a keyboard into our targeted form factor, which is why we can also hook up a simple gamepad, map its entire buttons, and use that as an input controller. But I really didn't feel like dealing with the gamepad PCB and buttons, which is why I had a closer look at the Arduino of the LattePanda, and realized that it uses the Atmega 32U4, which is also used in the Arduino Leonardo, which coincidentally can also act as a gamepad. So I installed the Arduino joystick library and used it to write a bit of code which maps the different pins of the Atmega IC to a button of a gamepad. After then opening the sketch on the LattePanda, selecting the Arduino Leonardo as a target and uploading it, it seems like a new gamepad got successfully recognized. Here you can see which pin of the LattePanda Arduino acts as which button. And after soldering wires to a tactile push button and hooking it up between one of the shown pins and ground, you can see that Windows successfully detects the button push, and thus we can use it in the RetroArch software. The last two components we need for the hardware setup are a small speaker and a 3.5mm audio jack. The audio jack will later be mounted inside the housing of the game console and wired up to the LattePanda audio jack, which means it can be used to plug in headphones. The speaker will obviously also later be secured inside the housing and directly hooked up to the screen's audio amplifier through the help of its included connector wire. Its volume can then easily get adjusted through the push buttons mounted on the screen's PCB. But wait a minute, that means those push buttons, along with the LattePanda's power button, also need a tactile push button extension mounted inside the housing. And that was the point I started creating a couple of sketches how the game console should look like and where all the mandatory components should be placed. With those blueprints in mind, I started creating 3D models of all the important components with their mounting holes in Fusion 360. To do that, I either had to manually measure the components or use the dimensions I found on the internet. And with those models, I was not only able to figure out the size of the game console, but I was also able to create precise mounting holes for all of them. And after 50 versions of my design and around 10 hours, this was the housing I was finally happy with. So I printed its upper half with black PLA filaments, its lower half with white filaments, and all the button caps, shoulder pads, and holding parts with red filaments. As soon as I got all the 3D printed parts, I removed their support material, did a bit of extra treatment for some sections, and started the assembly by grabbing dozens of 9.5mm long tactile push buttons and soldering two wires to each of them. After that was done, I positioned the 3D printed button caps inside their holes, pushed the tactile switches into them, for which I also later used a bit of hot glue, created a common ground for all the buttons, and used a mounting plate and M3 screws in order to tighten it all to the housing. You need to fine adjust the distance of the mounting plates until you get a satisfying button push. I then repeated this process for the other side, as well as for all the buttons of the screen and the LattePanda power button. Next, I hot glued a tactile push button near each shoulder pad and double checked whether they would mechanically work later on, which they did. At this point, I secured the speaker, USB Type-C PD PCB, and audio jack inside the housing with a bit of two-component adhesive. Then I finally secured the LattePanda as well as the screen in place with more M3 screws, added mail headers to the LattePanda Arduino and wired up most of the buttons to it. The rest got connected to the screen or the LattePanda power button. But do not worry if you didn't get all the details, because you can find more pictures and information about this project, as always, in the video description. And after wiring up the audio jack and speaker, it was time to solder the LattePanda micro USB cable to power, from which I used another chopped up USB cable to power the screen. As you can see, there was a lack of space, which also forced me to directly solder the data wires of the touch ports to another USB cable, which then got plugged into the LattePanda. And just like that, the electrical wiring was complete, which means it was time to close the system up and use more M3 screws to hold the two halves together. And as you can see, by powering it with the power bank, it all still works just fine. I hope you enjoyed this project, and maybe I even inspired you to create something similar. If so, don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and hit the notification bell. Stay creative, and I will see you next time!